Hello again. I'm Dr. Steve Klein from the Department of Communication at the University of Missouri. Welcome to another online video lesson intended to provide you important principles and helpful concepts in the study of communication. This video is the second of a three-part series that's looking at some simple yet powerful fundamental theoretical models of how communication operates. The moral of the story of this three video series is that each of these models can provide us a distinctive way of looking at how communication works in ways that are especially useful for specific kinds and types of communication situations. Yet at the same time, all of these models are going to contain within them some core fundamental elements of communication that are going to be in place and be really important regardless of the specifics of that situation. Now, the first video in this series was the transmission model of communication, and I want to do a very brief review of that first so that we can have a basis of comparison for understanding how the interactional model is going to be both similar and very different. You may recall, if you saw that previous video, that the transmission model is going to begin with a specific message source. Who is it or what is it that has some specific thoughts or ideas, what the framers of this model referred to as information, that needs to be conveyed to an audience? What the source is going to do is to take those thoughts and ideas and information and encode them into a message. A message essentially is a form of using signs and symbols to put the thoughts, etc., into a form that somebody else is going to be able to understand. So, in this case, lyrics and beats are being used to lay down tracks of hip-hop music. Now, that message is going to be carried to whoever is going to receive it over a specific channel. A channel, as you recall, is essentially the sensory route that a message takes as it's going from the source to the receiver. Now, of course, in this case, this musician is probably looking to get that message to a broad audience and not just a single point receiver. And so the message is going to need to rely on a channel that uses some form of technology to make sure it gets where it needs to go. And when we're talking about channels that use technology, we refer to these as media. So in this case, the medium being used is digital music technology that will be uploaded and shared and downloaded to a particular receiver. Once the receiver downloads these tracks and starts listening, the receiver is going to decode the message. In other words, listen to the music, listen to the lyrics, and try to figure out what the thoughts and ideas were that the musician is trying to convey. And at various points in this track from source to receiver, there's going to be the possibility of noise, any kind of phenomenon that might potentially distract from or interfere with the successful communication process. So you can see that the transmission model is a relatively one-way model for communication, moving from source to receiver, the source basically being the most active participant, whereas the receiver takes a more passive role. Now, subsequent researchers are asking the question, is there more to communication than just this one-way flow of information? One of those important scholars was Wilbur Schramm, who did research and theory building to try to refine Shannon and Weaver's linear model. And Schramm is especially interested in what kind of thing happens once the receiver actually gets the message and decodes it. Is that the end of the story, or does the story continue? And as you might guess, because we are going to talk about another model, the story is going to continue. In order to illustrate this story, let's take a look at a slightly different communication situation, although one that is also going to have a source and a receiver involved. In this case, it's a public speech at an academic or professional conference, where the speaker is presenting the results of research in a presentation that's intended for an audience of that source's peers. So much of the process from the transmission model is going to carry through as expected. The source has ideas, the thoughts, the information that came out of the research, and that then is going to lead to the encoding of a message first the writing of a paper and then changing that paper into a public speech presentation that then is going to be carried through a channel. In other words, the light waves and sound waves in the space between the source and the receiver that are going to carry the speaker's voice, the speaker's gestures and nonverbal expression, as well as anything that's being displayed on that screen that you can probably see behind her. PowerPoint slides, charts and graphs, photographs, maybe some video, whatever it happens to be. So the message is the public speech and the various things that are encoded into it. And the channel is how we get it from the speaker to the audience. And then, of course, as you might imagine, the receiver then is going to engage in decoding the message, listening to the speech, seeing the things that are on the screen and making sense out of them. But if you've ever been to a public speech as an audience member or as a speaker yourself, you know that this is not the end of the story. Because while the speaker is speaking, the receiver is responding to that message with a variety of things. They could be establishing eye contact and nodding when they hear something they like. They could be taking notes. They could be rolling their eyes and looking sleepy or perturbed. They could be glancing down at a faint electronic glow from their lap that currently has their attention more so than the speaker does. So as a response to the speech that they're hearing, the receiver, the audience in this case, is also a message source that's going to be encoding their own message, a message that we often refer to as feedback, taking this message that's intended to go to the source of the message, or perhaps, of course, messages that aren't necessarily intentionally sent to the source, but get to the source nonetheless, through the channel of a space that enables the nonverbal communication to be seen by the speaker. Now, the source, as we teach in public speaking, ought to be paying attention to the nonverbal feedback from the receiver, because that source is then going to become a receiver who will be decoding the message being sent by the audience. Well, gee whiz, my audience is looking really sleepy and distracted, and they're rolling their eyes, and some of them look like they're really kind of annoyed to be here, and there's a few people that are just texting or doing Twitter. I can tell that from here. Maybe they're bored? Maybe I need to do something else. And so then in response to the message that's coming from the audience, this speaker then is going to perhaps change up the way that she's encoding the message. Maybe she's going to present a more energetic, engaging delivery. Maybe she's going to bring in a particular visual representation on her PowerPoint that she was saving in case she actually needed it. Maybe she's going to go back to a previous point and try to illustrate it with a more compelling, concrete example. So the new elements of the message will be sent through the channel back to the audience, who will decode it and then encode another feedback response. Hey, this is actually getting pretty interesting. Maybe I sit up in my chair a little bit straighter. Maybe I start establishing full contact with my eyes and face towards the speaker. Maybe I do start taking those notes. And then these nonverbal messages are going to get sent back to the source through the channel, who is going to decode them. Oh, they're paying attention. This must mean they're a bit more into it now. And this tells me that now I'm doing the kind of thing that I need to be doing. And so on and so on. After the speech is over, the audience applauds. The applause provides positive feedback that the speech did some good things. The speaker responds by saying thank you. The audience may start asking questions, to which the speaker will answer them. And you can see how this circular loop continues. Now, of course, there's the possibility of noise at various points in this communication situation. And it's not necessarily just going to be the technological noise of things in the channel that might disrupt the flow from the source to the receiver. We can understand noise from a lot of different contexts. Perhaps the speaker is internally distracted. Maybe she's bummed out by the negative feedback she's getting from the audience, and maybe it actually throws her off her game, so she ends up communicating less effectively. Maybe the audience is experiencing physiological noise because they're very tired or they're very hungry or they're sleepy because it's just after lunch. Maybe they're experiencing psychological noise because there's other things that they would much rather be doing than sitting in this presentation. And so there's lots of potential things that might interfere with the flow of communication in this turn-taking model. So you can see that there's a lot of things very similar so far with the transmission model. We've got speaker encoding a message, sending that message through a channel. It's received by the receiver who decodes the message, and noise can disrupt this stuff. But the feedback loop that goes from receiver to source, building in this circular turn-taking element to communication, is something that's profoundly different than the transmission model. In Schramm's work and those who followed that work, there's also another really important element that we don't see in the transmission model. And that is that all of this stuff that we've been talking about so far takes place within a specific context. Context is essentially all of the conditions that surround and have influences on any particular communication situation. So we could be talking about physical context, everything from the time of day to the temperature of the room to how the room is physically situated with rows of desks in front of a speaker who's up front. We can have psychological context, such as the amount of personal significance the speaker has in the success of this presentation, relative to the importance or potential lack of importance of any of the audience members who happen to be there. Related to these, there could be situational context. The nature of this conference. Why are all these people together for these meetings in the first place? What is it about the topic area of the presentation that relates to other things that are surrounding the audience and surrounding the speaker? So we can't really understand what the source and the receiver are doing, the encoding and decoding of messages and the functioning of channels, outside of thinking about these contextual matters that are going to have a big impact on how the communication operates. So, if we want to really sum up the important distinctive elements of the interactional model, there's a couple of things we can identify. First, we're talking about bilateral communication. If the unilateral communication is one way in the transmission model between the source and the receiver, bilateral communication means that both participants are going to be taking part in the communication process. And the interactional model depicts this through the process of circular turn-taking. Another really important element is that this kind of communication is symmetric. Rather than the source having all of the power and influence in the situation, the receiver of the message also has a really important role because they're going to be providing feedback to that original source that's going to influence the way that that source continues to communicate to the receiver, and it keeps going through this turn-taking process. And finally, the role of context is extremely important in understanding how this turn-taking results in an exchange of meaning. That's the interactional model. If you've got any questions about this or any of the videos in the series, please don't hesitate to reach out and let me know. Otherwise, I'll see you in the next video.